Back to Hello Nigeria. We have our first guest in the studio. Today we're going to be looking at dyslexia. Many people have or have not heard about dyslexia. And today we're going to be throwing more light on what the term dyslexia means. How prevalent is it in Nigeria? How much awareness do we have about dyslexia in Nigeria? Now, joining us is someone from a foundation that does more about advocacy with regards to dyslexia. His name is Chukwueze Moses, and he's a dyslexia activist from the Dyslexia Foundation of Nigeria. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for having me.
So usually when you hear people who are activists for certain causes, a lot of times it's born out of personal experiences or experiences from close or, you know, family members. So are you dyslexic yourself, or what informed your decision to become a dyslexic activist?
Yeah. Well, first, I am not dyslexic, but the founder of the foundation, his son is dyslexic. And because of the challenge he went through trying to find an appropriate intervention and help and support for his son, led to him starting the foundation. Before he got to that point, he had practically gone over different parts of Nigeria trying to seek for intervention, trying to find support, but he couldn't get. So he eventually got that in America. And so for him, it was shocking. And he also got to know about dyslexia in America. So for him, it was quite strange that we don't have such awareness about dyslexia here in Nigeria. So that really influenced the choice around, okay, if my son has this and is struggling with this challenge, there are other children, millions of them, that are going through this challenge without proper intervention, without proper assessment, without proper support and accommodation, and eventually they labeled them wrongly. So that influenced our work and the setting up of the foundation. We started officially in 2015. That's when we started officially. Then since then, we've been trying to push the boundaries of our awareness to different parts of the country.
Okay, so I know that dyslexia was actually, the first dyslexic patient was actually discovered in England, 1969, if I'm not wrong.
True.
Dr. Morgan Pringle.
True. True.
And then at that time, in that community in England, it was about 1 out of 15, 20 children. And then in Nigeria now, we had a statistic some years ago that was 1 out of 6 children below the age of 13. Does that statistic still stand right now?
Well, that statistics actually is very relevant. It's a World Health Organization statistics that says 1 out of every 6 population is dyslexic. Now, presently in Nigeria, we don't have any current substantive evidence to support this. However, we know that 1 out of every 6 people is dyslexic. We have over 32 million people. If you look at the Nigerian population and put it side by side with the figure, that will give you over that figure. But that's what we are doing at the foundation presently. The face of our work is to do a national survey, which we're going to do in the first half of this year, to substantiate the number of those who are dyslexic. However, dyslexia is not just for those who are lower than a particular age. It's a spectrum that cuts across, even from age 5, from age 0 to old age to any time. So it's cuts across different age range and demographics of the population. So what we're trying to do at the foundation currently now is to find and substantiate the evidence around it. But then, for those who will be listening for the first time, I think it's always very important to say this.
Okay.
To understand what dyslexia is and what dyslexia is not.
That was going to be my next question to you. You know, what exactly is dyslexia for those who have never heard the term before?
Very good. Very good. So for dyslexia, spelled as D-Y-S-L-E-X-I-A, now is not a problem of lack of intelligence. It's not a challenge that people who have this challenge are lazy. It's not a problem of hard work or laziness. Is a brain condition. And as a brain condition, it affects the language skills. Now, language skills, from the basic language skills to more complex language skills. Now, the basic language skills of reading, writing, spelling, pronunciation, comprehension, those are those basic skills that it affects. Now, when we say it's a brain condition, like I heard someone saying it's a challenge, it's a disability and all that, I always want to always clarify this. Dyslexia is not, I try to say it as, it's not a problem of disability per se, because when we use the word disability, it's been abused over time in our society. People try to attach negative connotation to disability. So it's a challenge. And a very recent stem from the field of neuroscience, those who are researching actively in that area, says it's a challenge of neurodiverse. They are neurodiverse. Their brains are wired differently. So not the way we are wired. So when we say it's a brain condition that affects reading, writing, spelling, comprehension, now we also say that dyslexic, they may have challenge with trying to sound words. They will have challenge trying to blend words. They fall back in class oftentimes when you look at their grades. And oftentimes they are labeled wrongly as quote unquote olodo, lazy. Sometimes their parents even hit them because they are trying to make sense of it. This is because the way they receive information, process information, and give out information is different from the way every other brain processes that information. So because of that, I would say our society is not actually ready for them at this time.
Okay. So, what I want to ask now is with regards to our schools.
Yeah.
I know that growing up as well, even I was a teacher at some point, and you would see some pupils finding it extremely difficult to comprehend, extremely difficult to spell. Simple things. I remember a little boy telling the boy to spell orange, and he started with something like WK, and I'm like, what
Fantastic.
Is going on? At the time, I had no knowledge about what dyslexia was. So now in our schools, are teachers being taught about dyslexia so that they know how to, you know, maybe employ new tactics in teaching these children to aid assimilation?
Now, just to quickly follow up to that, we had our teachers training twice last year, and we carried out a survey in our teachers training, and all the centers where we had that showed that more teachers are less aware about dyslexia. And in fact, in teachers training colleges where they prepare them to come to the society to teach, where they prepare them as teachers, they often don't even pay attention to what it means to have this type of learning challenge. So our teachers, majority of them, are not aware about dyslexia. So it becomes a whole lot of challenge because they don't know how to intervene, they don't know the kind of accommodation and support the child needs to have in classroom, then they just label wrongly.
Exactly.
Okay. You know. Okay, so now I'm going to ask, still on the issue of teachers and, you know, the dyslexic student.
Yeah.
I remember there was a time when I read about it and we had an issue, you know, like talking about it in school then. And someone actually suggested this, and I said, okay, good, that they should be giving extra 30 minutes in an exam hall. And the school authority went like, how can you guys see that kind of a thing? Now, what has the foundation done in making sure that the students who are discovered, for those who are discovered to be dyslexic, maybe they give them extra time or something? What has been done to make sure that those who come out and say, okay, my child is dyslexic, how can you help him or her in school? What is done?
Yeah, well, quickly, last year, just in October, we had a national conference on dyslexia. And the team of the conference actually paid attention to policymakers and those in education, workplace and accommodation policies for those with dyslexia. We had Minister of Education and Minister of Labor and Productivity attended, even they sent in their reps, but however they came and they acknowledged the conference. So what we're trying to push in is that what you said is quite very viable, and this is the direction we are saying, that people with dyslexic, they need some type of accommodation in classroom one. Now, in trying to even measure performance, sometimes and most times their style of measurement should be different from the other people. And their type of accommodation, they need extra time. That is objective. Now, why do they need extra time? Not because the extra time is given to them to keep them ahead of others. Now, because they have a challenge with processing information, the extra time given to them is to help them make sense of what the question is saying. Because let's look at the neuropsychology of dyslexia. The part of the brain responsible for processing that language information, processing written information, has less activity. By that I mean there are less neural cells in that area. So it takes them more time to read a very simple passage, to comprehend and process.
Okay.
So they need extra time, which we advocated at the conference. In fact, the speakers we brought at the conference from those who are not from outside the country actually said that even abroad, people who are dyslexic, they give them extra time during exam.
Okay.
We have one of our friends who is dyslexic studying medicine abroad. She said to us that for every of her exam, they give her extra 15 minutes.
Okay.
And the time is just to make sense of what she needs to do and at the same time help her to capture
her
thoughts.
I'm hoping that, you know, beyond advocating for more time for dyslexic students, that we'll see more education for the teachers as well as parents of dyslexic students, you know, to encourage them and educate them on how best to manage this. We know dyslexia is not an illness, it's not a life sentence. Several people around the world have lived influential lives, even with dyslexia, from Muhammad Ali you know, Jennifer Aniston to Richard Branson and lots of other people. So a parent who is just probably thinking or who just found out that their child is dyslexic, what would you say to that parent in a few seconds?
The first thing to do, the first call for intervention is assessment. We cannot label anyone based on the things we've read on the internet or based on information available to us and say this person is dyslexic, because you may be surprised that this child is not dyslexic, maybe having other challenges.
So how do you
but
find
the
that
first
out?
Thing is to do an assessment, comprehensive assessment, not a roadside assessment. We have our centers all over. You can visit us on our website and check us, www.dyslexiafoundation.org.ng. You see our centers all over the nation. Come in for assessment. Assessment is the very first step of intervention. Without assessment, we might just be speculating. And in the realm of science and in the realm of intervention, we try to do away with speculative thinking to say objectively, this child is having dyslexia or this child is having XYZ challenge and all that. So the first thing for any parents is look up, find out our locations, our centers on our website. I've just given that out to go for an assessment.
Okay.
Assessment is just the first step. And for teachers too, you can also look up on our website and see the things you need to know. And funny enough, we have books that you can also read. You can speak to us and we'll give you the handbook where you can look at accommodation strategies that you can implement right in the classroom to help people who are dyslexic
so
to go through that.
All the documents and everything that they will need is on your website as
well. Yeah, when they get to the website, you can even call us and we'll share all the information.
www.dyslexiafoundation.org.ng. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you very much for
having
me.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
To enjoy more of these our Ogbonge videos when you just watch, press this button to subscribe on top of our YouTube page. You go love her.